chart toppers will gladly inform them. With their debut album, a top 30 hit on the Billboard pop chart, the members of Trickster decided to pay a triumphant visit to their old high school in Paramus, New Jersey recently. And Tabitha Soren, the newest addition to our MTV News team, was on hand to share those golden memories. Tabitha?
Thanks, Kurt. Most rock and roll musicians wouldn't even dream of coming back to their old high school, probably because they were all delinquents. But the band Trickster doesn't have that problem. They've come back.
Attention, students. Trickster is returning to Paramus High School. Please move in an orderly fashion to the cafeteria at this time.
Say, kid, you got a hall pass? Come on, Melvin.
Hey, how are you?
This is known as the commons area. This is where it's common to be seen in class. Class.
We were all so excited. All the adrenaline was flowing, and as soon as we got into the cafeteria, that was it.
I was the star food fight to this cafeteria. It's no big deal. Don't worry about it. Good to get out of class, right?
What year did you guys graduate from school? Just going offhand.
Graduated all around, basically. We graduated in the 80s.
Well, let's just say it's been a while since most of Trickster has been in high school.
Hey, baby, tell me what's your name.
But there are some things about school they'll never forget. So here we have a smorgasbord of vintage high school cafeteria food.
Vintage.
What's the best stuff?
Vintage. That's pretty scary, that word, first of all, using
high school. Well, some of the stuff is pretty scary.
I'm sorry.
So what would you say that is right there?
That's remnant, actually.
But the pizza looks pretty good.
The pizza's got to go down as my favorite.
So for aspiring rockers, you basically recommend the pizza.
Pizza. Or the 7-Eleven down the street.
They're all over school. The posters are all over.
Yeah, they hit a parade.
Trix is not my favorite band. AC/DC is, but it's good that it got us out of class.
You know, just because that's my hometown and everything.
We played to, 10,000 people last night in California, and today we played to 50 in a cafeteria. I like it.
On their way out, drummer Mark Scott ran into his old band, the Paramus High School Marching Spartans.
His hair coming out of the band hat.
All things apparently paid off. In Paramus, anyway. And they say no matter how big it gets, fame won't turn their heads.
People get the idea that you're just gonna like fly off, go to live in Hollywood or something like that. I love New Jersey. This is ticket.
Hey, look, man, you got your problems and we got...
up there in Facebook land and Robert's Report land. One minute to airtime. I'd like to see you naked. Strip down and show me who you really are. I want your secrets and band-aids. Never mind the tattoos covering your heart. When you speak, just speak directly. When you want, just point. Studios in South Parkersburg, West Virginia. This is Robert's Report, your leader in combat sports and rock music. And now, your host of Robert's Report, Craig Vegas Roberts. Good evening, everybody, and welcome to Robert's Report. I am your host, Craig Roberts. We've got a jam-packed show for you this evening. And I would be lying if I wasn't going to pull fanboy on everybody here because Trickster. But we'll get to that here in just a few minutes. First of all, we got some, of course, go over a little bit of rock news here. I don't know, this was kind of interesting to me. I thought Vince Neil was spotted in church with Mike Wolf of American Pickers. And I don't know. You know, I guess the only reason why you always think of Vince Neil and, you know, Shout Out the Devil and all that kind of stuff. But one of his interviews, he mentioned about he doesn't believe in religion, but he believes he will see his daughter again. So I don't know. It's just a little tidbit. Getting ready. Maybe he's getting warmed up for the big tour here in 2020, which we're going to go see in August in Pittsburgh. Thank you very much. A couple more things. I Prevail singer paid off his father's mortgage, which was kind of cool. That's the kind of things that you should do for your family, I think, whenever you do get to the point where you can do things like that. I think we all got to look out for each other. The band Otherwise, on a special end-of-year concert at the I believe it was the Vinyl in Las Vegas there. It was a last show for their drummer, Brian Medeiros, and Tony Carboni. And actually, Corky Gainsford actually joined them on stage for the song Soldiers, which was kind of a cool little show there. Of course, we are also remembering a couple people, the Rev from Avenged Sevenfold, 10 years gone. Lemmy Kilmister from, Motorhead. Thank you. Sorry. 4 years gone, which is hard to believe. It just seems like it just showed up on the news yesterday. Big show in, Ohio is coming up, Incarceration. And what was kind of cool about that, I thought, in my opinion, the lineup was actually a little bit better than Sonic Temple, in my opinion. Yeah, they got Limp Bizkit, Weezer, Blink 182, Papa Roach, about all of the bands you recognize. And then in the world of MMA news, so January 18th, of course, we got McGregor versus Notorious One versus Cowboy coming up January 18th. We got Holly Holm on that, Claudia Gadelha, Anthony Pettis is on that bill, and some other good ones. And then, of course, another big thing in MMA for the Mid-Ohio Valley here is returning to Columbus, Ohio on a fight night. So UFC fight night, Francis Ngannou and Cody Garbrandt are going to return to the scene. So we look forward to that in the MMA and rock world this year. I guess that kind of brings us to our special guest of the evening here. Let me get my thing going here. It is gives me great pleasure here to welcome Mr. Mark Gus Scott, drummer for Trickster, into the Man Cave Studios here. How you doing, Mark?
Hey, Vegas Roberts, how are you, sir? Honored to be here. Roberts Report, kicking some butt, baby.
Yeah. Sunday. Yes, yes. We appreciate you taking your time out of your busy schedule to spend some time and maybe answer some questions and some some remembering some of your good times of the past, that sort of thing. That's what we like. That's what we like to do, right?
God bless America. Sure. Sounds like a great way to spend the Sunday.
So just to give kind of, and forgive me cause I got my information from Wikipedia. Hopefully one of you all have went in and approved Wikipedia.
I shall confirm or deny.
but your first self-titled album reaches highest 28 on the Billboard 200. And, it went gold, of course. Give It To Me Good, Surrender, One in a Million, of course, came off of that album, huge hits. And I'm a huge fan, Mark. Honestly,
God bless you. Appreciate that. Thank you. So am I.
been a huge fan since 89-ish. I was the year I graduated, so we spent many times going to Charleston Civic Center here in Charleston, West Virginia. And I believe you've played
West Virginia.
Yeah. As you were mentioning,
we had a little chat earlier. We had some fun in West Virginia.
Yeah. Well, we like to partake in every now and then. So nothing wrong with that. Sitting down with cold beer with a good friend.
As long as you don't take one, everything's fine.
For sure. So to be honest with you, I haven't had anybody of your caliber on my show yet, so I finally get to ask the question, what the heck was it like, coming out of, you're out of high school, well, of course you were already out of high school, and
and of course, graduated in 86.
Yeah, and I think Pete and PJ were still in school, so I believe.
Pete graduated 84. I graduated 86. Pete graduated 88. And PJ, this is funny, PJ, it was 2 years after Steve, so that was 1990 technically is when he graduated.
Oh, jeez.
It's funny, we were recording the first record while PJ was still in high school. He had to get special permission to be excused to go to record the record, and the producer had to sign off that he played his bass X amount of hours a week to qualify for his physical education requirement. I swear to God, that's the truth. That is the truth. I don't know how many hours it's supposed to be, but I'm sure he would have exceeded the standard anyway because he played all day, right. But yeah, that's the truth. He had to get special permission to go and do the record in California. And our producer signed off on him playing X amount of hours on a daily basis, and that satisfied his physical education requirement. I believe he did some final testing to make sure he could graduate, but that's what he had to do. It was somewhat unconventional for your average senior.
Yeah, so back up just a little bit. I did did a little more research, too, on how you all actually, I guess you're riding your skateboard past a a garage or something, or I don't know if this it, and you just happened to hear Steve Brown playing guitar.
Yeah. You know, it's funny. I grew up, I went to private school. I was somewhat sheltered. I didn't learn about rock and roll till, I guess, later than most kids find out what it's all about. And Steve was the second person I ever saw play guitar. The first guy I saw, I was like 22 years old or something. And it was a backyard barbecue my babysitter took me to. And it was the first time I saw a real live rock band. I was like, wow, this is pretty cool. And the guy played guitar. He was pretty good. You know, he's pretty good. But right. Steve, it's funny. I used to ride bicycles at the dirt trails up the road from my house. And Steve come by one day and he was younger. He was 2 years younger, you know, and particularly when you're like, you know, 13, 15 years old and you run into some kid that's younger than you, you know, mm-hmm. it's like, you don't think much of him. So he goes, I play guitar, man. I go, oh boy, he plays guitar, you know? So he says, why don't you come on over? I'll show you. I'm like, okay. I reluctantly say, you know, whatever, let's go. I follow him back to his house about a mile away. he runs up the stairs. I'm looking, I'm like, there's no way this kid's going to play guitar. So he whips out this guitar and it's a real deal electric guitar. I go, wow, that's kind of cool. You know, and things bigger than him. So I said, how good could he possibly play this thing? You know what I mean? So puts an eye, plugs in an amp, makes a couple of noises. And all of a sudden, this kid tears my head off. I could not believe, I first off didn't think that playing guitar like that was possible, you know, which was amazing. He starts playing some AC/DC, he's playing Kiss, he's playing his own stuff. And when he played leads, his hand would go back and forth so fast, it would blur in front of the strings. I said, Jesus, I couldn't believe it, you know? So that was the first time that I heard someone really shred. And even at that young age, the kid really had something, you know? So it left a real impression in my mind. So one day, back to your story, I'm skateboarding to the local music shop. I needed a drum head or something. You know, I passed by this garage and through that door was closed and I hear him jamming. I hear this guitar and said, man, that sounds a hell of a lot the way Steve was playing that day up in his bedroom, you know? So I go get my drum head. I come on back and I pass the garage again, you know, and I stop. It was, they were still playing and I sit on the sidewalk and on the curb and all of a sudden the garage opens and out comes Steve. I'm like, that son of a bitch. I knew it. You know, they had some other drummer and I knew I could play better than him, but he was already in the band, you know? So, I said, I gotta be around this. I love it so much. I said, I'll be the lighting guy. So I was the lighting guy for their first show at Eastbrook Middle School in Paramus, New Jersey. And man, they brought down the house. It was fantastic. And after that one show, the drummer had to go to college. Oh, so there were some auditions. It was down between me and this other guy. And I don't know, I guess I got the gig. And the band started calling itself Trickster after I joined.
And it was Raid, I believe, or something like that before. Is correct. That correct?
R-A-D-E. Yeah, it was. that's correct. The first band name was Raid, and then I guess after I joined, they changed the name, and that was between 1984 and 85. 84 and 85. When I actually joined in 84, I believe it was our first show. If I'm not mistaken, was June. It was summertime of 1985. If I'm not mistaken, but 84, 85. I joined when I was 16 and I had my car 17. I'm trying to figure out. So I guess it was 1985. I think it was summer of 85 for our first show at the Paramus Band Shell behind the public library. And that was wild. We had some big brothers in a band called Harlot. And most notably, the singer Ray Gillen was the singer of that band. He, most people know, is the lead singer of Badlands, who was famous, who also got into Black Sabbath. He was an amazing vocalist. And it was him, Ross Barata, George Pagonis, the guys in Harlot that was kind of like our big brother mentor. Said, guys, we're going to help you with the lights. We'll help you with the PA. This is what you got to do. You got to load in at this time. That, you know, they helped push us off in the right direction, you know, helped us get all the stuff. What the heck did we know about lighting? What do we know about sound systems and stuff? You know, so we had, you know, a lot of people say, you're an overnight sensation. We did a lot of learning. We were very young. We didn't know everything. We had a lot of help, man, you know. And thank God, I think with any successful operation, you know, I don't care if you run a convenience store or, you know, you're trying to, you know, make garbage bags. You know, there's help along the way to make it successful. Not everything is yourself. You have the desire to do it yourself, but you don't always have the smarts. You don't always, you know what the right thing to do is. So, you know, thank God we certainly acknowledge the fact that, you know, we couldn't have done it ourselves.
You were talking about Steve Brown.
Yes, sir.
The man, the myth.
Yeah, man. Extraordinaire.
Yeah, so I've got something to kind of talk on Steve Brown as well there. We went to M3 there last, or, well, yeah, I guess it's last year now, and I didn't realize what kind of a hired gun that dude is on lead guitar as well.
He plays with a lot of people, that's for sure.
I mean, he plays with Rubik's Cube. I think he still does that. I haven't seen too many things on it here lately. He stood in for Vivian with Def Leppard during his cancer treatments, and this was with Danger Danger at M3. I had to look twice. I was like, is that Steve Brown? So
that's it.
But yeah, that
he does some work with Dennis DeYoung, Jolin Turner. He's he keeps busy, that's for sure.
Yeah, he's quite the I guess I don't know if all guitarists are, you know, lead guitarists are that diversified, I should say, but it was certainly.
I gotta tell you, for sure, when you change bands like that, I don't know how you keep all the music straight. That's like a lot. That's a huge volume of material to keep in your head. I don't know, man. Hats off, because I can't. I don't know. I don't know if I could pull that off. I'm not that smart.
Yeah, I've got a friend out there in Vegas. It's actually his band. I was talking about before the show there. It used to be in Otherwise with Corky Gainsford.
Mm-hmm.
And he plays for the Blue Man's group. He's doing a tour with them, and he does all these things with but yeah, I mean, I'm not a musician. I don't know how to play. I've tinkered on an acoustic guitar, and that's the extent of it. But I couldn't imagine just picking up songs, you know, in a day's time. I mean, hats off to everybody that does that. So
yeah.
So let's see here. We're just going down through. I guess in 2010. Let's see. You all kind of split for a little while back in 95-ish, or
yes, sir. Right.
And
I'm trying to think how it really went. We started. I guess I joined in 84. 85 was our first show, and then we signed with MCA Records in 88, recorded the record, album came, signed in 89, album came out in 1990. Things started to go well with radio and MTV towards the end of 90 through 91. That was when things were very strong, thank God. We toured with, geez, let's go through it. Stryper, Don Donkin, Kiss, first came Poison, then Scorpions, Slaughter. Then we did the Blood, Sweat, and Beers tour with Firehouse and Warrant. Huge, biggest tour in 91. Played everywhere, literally everywhere. Then in 92, toured with Kiss. And then we did a whole club and theater thing on our own. And that's when things started to turn south. So in 95, we did this band. And then that brought us, we went our own ways. People got married like myself and had kids and did different things in life. We put it back together in 2007, 2008, and did a very triumphant return. We had a lot of fun, had a new record come out, Alive in Japan, a recording we did in 1994. That was released as a live record. And then we signed a new deal with Frontiers, and we put out two records with them. New Audio Machine debuted number 56 on iTunes, and then Human Era, which came out, I believe that was 2014, 2015, I think 2015. And then, amazing. Just an amazing comeback. We played literally with everybody. Cinderella, The Scorpions, Ted Nugent, Dokken, Warrant, Winger, Firehouse. I know I'm going to forget people. Vince Neil. I don't know. I mean, it was crazy. We played that Kix, our good friends Kix, everybody. We had so much fun. So much fun. Crazy.
Man, Kix is quite amazing live still, by the way. I mean,
even before, you know, we were signed. I mean, God, we were opening for them in the Jersey clubs and stuff, you know. I mean, and then nationally, you know, all across America. It's amazing. We've known those guys for like 30 years. And to see them still kicking butt like that, it's just crazy. Yeah. You know, they live band, they're fantastic. I love them a lot.
The amount Jimmy of the energy drummer, is just
like Jimmy. Yeah. Jimmy Chalice, my man.
So what was it like then? You know, you mentioned all these. I mean, here you are all of a sudden. And of course, I also heard about, you know, sneaking in to Bon Jovi show. That was kind of your in the Meadowlands.
That was one of them.
Yeah. But
we had a technique. You know, it's funny, before things started to happen for us, I actually worked backstage at a number of the New Jersey venues. One most notably was the Meadowlands Arena in East Rutherford, New Jersey. And my first working gig was loading in for David Lee Roth. And I did the load in, and between load in and load out, there was downtime. So they kind of cut you, and I get to walk around, got to see the show and hang out with the guys, met the guys in the Def Leppard and the David Lee Roth band, including Dave. And it was amazing. And one thing, the real advantage to it is I got to see the inner sanctum of the arena. And where all the passageways go and where all the stairways go. And I found a spot where you were able to get backstage without being detected. So I showed it to the guys, and we got to sneak down for every darn group that came through the Meadowlands. So, you know, what most notably was the Bon Jovi show. But what was funny, we knew John prior to that. So he would see us out in the crowd, say, "Hey, man, go, go." He'd be playing a show. And after the show, we'd be back to. You go, why the hell did you guys get back? So it was kind of funny, and it was really cool. Something that John did when he was friends with the Skid Row guys. They kind of grew up together, and particularly him and Dave Sabo, the guitar player. When the Skids got signed, they signed with Atlantic. When they got signed, John said, "Hey guys, when you play around the tri-state area, New York, New Jersey, Connecticut, have Trickster open up, you know, and, you know, maybe they'll get picked up." And that was a really cool thing doing. So when Skids played around the Jersey area, we got to open up for them. And that was really cool. And it was one day in Staten Island, New York, a place called On Stage, the Park Villa. We opened for the Skids, and that's when our manager saw us. Our manager was Ken Mako, who was a roommate of Rob Affuso, if I'm not mistaken. It was Rob Affuso's roommate in college. And he went to go see the Skids, and he happened to see us open for them. He's like, "Wow, I love these guys." And he grabbed us aside and said, "Hey, we should be talking. We got some work to do together." So that was cool. You know, that's really what started focusing us towards the higher level of performance, the higher level of making progress. And it was Shark Entertainment, Ken Mako and Joel Weinshanker that brought Trickster up the ladder and eventually got us signed to MCA Records.
So did you feel starstruck at all at this point? I mean,
as far as meeting on that level, yeah. You know, it's kind of funny. I had a teacher way back when, my old band director from high school. He says, you know, you hang out with robbers, you're going to become a robber. You hang out with good people, become a good person. Well, I figured, heck, if I hang out with rock stars, we'll see what happens, you know? So, you know, we tried to, you know, get back there as much as possible just to make friends, to make contact, to be around it, you know. When John Bon Jovi would go to the Hard Rock Cafe in New York to promote his records and do an interview, we'd be there, you know. Yeah. And we tried to make contact, and we did. And, you know, we got him a demo tape and a package, and he actually called Pete, our singer. And he said, "Hey, man, you got some more stuff. Send it to my management company." So every once in a while, every few weeks, me and Pete, we get all dressed up. We put a package together. We go to McGee Entertainment in New York and drop off a packet for John. We got, "Oh, man, we're going to make contact. We're going to, you know, getting all tight." And we do that with a lot of cats, you know. We try to get backstage for many shows just to make contact, just to be part of what's going on, you know, to have that association. And I think any step that people take to get into that direction, to be in that circle, that's a good place to be. You know, at least better than being by yourself. So,
right.
You know, that's pretty much the attitude that we had. And we were young little bastards, you know. So, but I shouldn't say everything that we did to make that happen. But we did some naughty little things that got us to where we wanted to get. And when I say naughty, like I'll give you a funny example. We would I won't say the band, but with, you know, there'd be a big show planned, and we'd get on the phone. We'd say,
"Yeah, this is JP from the management company. Yeah, I'm sending over. I need two more guys set on the guest list. I got Mark Scott plus one. Yeah, make sure he gets on there. All right, okay, I'll talk to you later. Bang." So I go show up at the box office, and Mark Scott plus one would be on the list. So I'm telling you, man, you know, that's what I mean by, you know, funny things. We had the balls just to do it, you know, and that was kind of funny. So, you know, that's just the way we made, you know, we tried to make it happen the best we could. I think sometimes it just takes a little bit of something, a little bit of push, a little bit of drive to, you know, make something like that happen where other people say, "Oh, you can't do that. You shouldn't do that." Well, I think you should take every opportunity to do that. You know, there's different ways of looking at it, and it produces results. Yeah. So that's, you know, that's just one example of something that we've done. But, you know, nothing like, you know, we didn't kill anybody to make it happen.
So what do you think? I mean, and you know, I'm trying to compare because there are some of the local bands. Of course, one of my questions in a little bit is going to be, you know, of the modern era music, is there anything you have in your, you know, your rotation or whatever, but, you know, comparing to what is out now and what was out back then, I feel, and I don't know if you agree or disagree with this, but I feel some of the bands lack the uniqueness of on each other. I mean, there's no other band that sounds like Trickster. There's no other band that sounds like Bon Jovi, you know?
I will agree with you. It is, particularly with newer music. I got to tell you, particularly having kids, I see what they start to listen to, and I actually get exposed to newer stuff coming out instead of getting stuck in my old vein of what I used to listen to, classic rock and all that. Right. You know, I'm open to the idea of someone coming out and hitting me with something. Mm-hmm. You know, like, whoa, this is all. And I can't tell you, just a very rare occasion that something impresses me. You know, and it happens all too infrequently with new music. I'm not going to say it's not out there at all. I mean, I'll give you an example. The Struts are a newer band that are kicking my butt right now. I think they're fantastic. Bruno Mars, in that vein of music, he has got it going on. His song quality is fantastic. The guy sings like a son of a gun. He can dance. He can do it all. Plays drums, too. He's fantastic, you know. But there's so much crap. So much crap. Even great artists that I listened to back in the day coming out with stuff today. Back in the old days, I couldn't wait for that new record to come out. I can count on them bringing something wonderful to the table. And man, today, it's like, it's crazy. You know, the rate of frequency at which great music is being produced is substantially less than what it used to be. Substantially. Like, I'm not going to say it's not there at all. But man, I hope I hear more, but I really don't. And I think you see that in movies. I think you see that in all kinds of reflections of our culture. You know, yeah. I think they're recycling more remakes instead of original material. And I think that's because that, you know, there's a lack of something inside. Everything's digital. Everything's different today. You know, a lack of heart being put into what's going on out there. I'm not saying it's not out there at all, but the rate of frequency is certainly less than what it used to be. And that's a shame, man, you know? Relying more now on computer-generated imagery and all kinds of digital crap instead of the heart and soul of a real song coming through or a real movie or whatever, you know? It's I see that as a huge change in popular culture today.
I think a band needs to put out a good, solid ballad now and then, which is another thing that is missed from, you know, it's the Cookie Monster sound through the whole entire song, and then that's the album. And then it's just, yeah. I mean, don't get me wrong. There's a couple of the bands, like I like Five Finger Death Punch. There's a couple of the ones that I do enjoy, and I like the twist that they put on the cover songs that they did do. But yeah, I mean, I think you lack a ballad, and if you can't do your song acoustically, it just, you know, that's another thing.
You touch on a very interesting point. It shouldn't matter whether you have the best production in the world or it's one guy jamming on an acoustic guitar. You remember MTV used to do that unplugged stuff?
Oh, yeah.
And that really separates the men from the boys. When I saw Prince do his unplugged, when I saw Stevie Ray Vaughan do his unplugged, it didn't matter, man. When they played, it was like, whoa. You know what I mean? They brought it, and it was just so amazing. And I think that's the mark of a great song. You know, if you're able to do it with stripped down and it's amazing, that says something. There's no disputing that, you know. Well, you and some people may like it, some people may not, but there's really no debate. When someone's got something special like that and you're playing it on acoustic guitar, it's not overproduced. It's something that comes from the heart, and I think that resonates with people more than anything. Sometimes too much production can ruin that effect, you know. Yeah. I think virtuosity is one thing, but a great song trumps everything.
There's a lot of studio bands out there. I mean, it's just and that's it. So
true.
It's sad. It really is sad.
I think there's too much of that prevalent in today's music. You know, I really do. And because it's so readily available now, everybody's got a recording studio in their house with Pro Tools and the sound studios that you have within your PC, for crying out loud. People are recording stuff on their phone. You know what I mean? Right. It's like, and some of them do a pretty darn good job. But again, we rely on that too much instead of real from the heart song quality. Great lyrical content, wonderful melody lines put together with words that mean something. You know, I think that's the essence of how a song should blossom. You know, and I think that's a vital thing that you've touched upon. Absolutely.
So are there any songs, you always wonder from a fan's point of view, is there any of your songs that you play that, man, you got to play this song again? You know what I mean?
You know, it's funny. And this is a weird thing. And again, maybe it's a perspective. As an individual playing in the band, one thing, Give It To Me Good, our first single. I remember the first time Steve played that for me. It was a demo, and it was a four-track demo, and it was just him and acoustic guitar when it starts out. And I got to tell you something, man. There's something that I heard that I was like, whoa, it knocked me the frig out. And again, one of those true signs of a great song, I believe, you know. But when you actually shoot the video and you do a 12-hour shoot and you play that song 103 times, whether you love that song or not, and I did love that song, but after hearing it that many times, it certainly wears upon you. And it's the kind of thing where you have to play it every night. It certainly does something to you. But man, I'll tell you what, when we start playing, everybody starts going crazy. It's like the first time every time, you know. But yeah, there's a couple songs that I'm like, oh, I don't know. But for the most part, there's songs I look forward to every night as well.
That's good. You know,
Line of Fire. One, we have this song Line of Fire. That was our first single we ever released to rock radio. And man, every time I play that line, we played it every show we ever played. I can't tell you, man, that song. I can't wait for that song to come around. I beat the crap out of it every night. Love it.
Yeah, mine is Surrender.
That's another one I look forward to playing all the time. And sometimes I hit harder in that song than I do in even some of the rock songs. For some reason, a lot of passion, and particularly in the chorus, I just belt that snare like there's no tomorrow. You know, I have the chance, because it's slow, I get to reach up high, come on down, bam, I freaking knock it out. I love playing Surrender. And you could see it like in videos and whatnot.
Oh, yeah.
I destroy it. I love playing that song. I really do.
And it's funny you mentioned that. That's something that you notice as well with from my point of view. You guys have a great time on stage every single time you're up there. If you're not, you're putting on one of the best, you know, covers of all time. But you can just tell that you all are having a great time, you know?
Well, number one, quite honestly, we are, you know. I mean, we played shows, there's three people in the audience. We played shows, there's 30,000 people in the audience. So, you know, it's first off, we love to, even in rehearsal, we're looking at each other, we're laughing our asses off and cracking jokes. We do the same thing live on stage, no matter how many people, you know. So we're having fun even by ourselves with nobody watching, you know. The fact that everybody's watching, having a great time on top of it, you know, we have the best job in the world. You know, how do you want to sit in a cubicle and dial a phone for 40 hours? You want to, like, you know, beat the crap out of a drum set? Okay. I have fun when I go to 7-Eleven, get a Slurpee, you know. So the idea of playing a rock show, how do you not have fun? I see some cats that are up there. It's like, really? You know, I couldn't play like that. So I played with the flu. I played with appendicitis. I played with Torque Testy. So I'm telling you what, man, it's, there's nothing I would rather do. think it's the greatest thing in the world, whether one person or 100,000 people are watching. That's how do you not have fun? I don't understand that at all. I think the other guys will say the same thing.
Yeah, there was one of the interviews I speak of was, I can't remember, forgive me, the guy that did it, but you were at M3, I think it was in 2013, maybe, 2014. Mm-hmm. And you could just kind of tell from the interviews, I mean, that, you know, y'all are true, you know, best friends. I mean,
we've known each other over 30 years, well over 30 years, and it's... Yeah, and like I say, you probably saw in the interview, it's just us hanging out. We're cracking jokes on each other, you know, and we're laughing our asses off. I'm typically a cackling hyena, you know. It's like this. It's fun.
Yeah. And here comes Pete walking in.
You got to choose to do this. You know, if you're not having fun, then maybe you ought to be doing something else. Yeah. You know, so.
I loved it when Pete walked in there.
Also, when we get together. You know, it's like we're just silly. We have fun doing what we have fun just going to the corner store to pick up a freaking Yoo-hoo. You know what I mean? So the idea of playing rock show or just hanging out all together, it's the greatest time. It's the greatest thing in the world.
Yeah, it makes it special for us too. I mean, there's nothing worse than having, you know, ones that going up there just going through the motions, and you know, you could tell they're self-destructing. I mean, even towards the end of the Richie Sambora era and the Bon Jovi, it was just, you could just tell that just there just wasn't quite that connection there between them that there used to be.
Yeah, you know, you touch on an interesting subject there. The core element of harmony within the band. If you don't have that, how do you expect the audience to have that? You know what I mean? So that's a very interesting point you're making there. And I agree with it, you know. You got to have that harmony there. I mean, you could try to fake it. Maybe it'll work. I don't know. We never really had to, you know. And no matter what was going on in our lives, something bad, something good, when we saw each other, it was like, dude, you know, and the party was on and we were all silly. You know, that's just us. I really can't speak for other bands. But you do bring up an interesting point. If you don't have some, you know, good harmony going on, you know, personally with the guys, with your bandmates, you know, how do you expect audience people to relate to it or have a good time about it, you know, or enjoy what you do if you're not digging it? So, I don't know. One thing's for sure, with Trickster, from day one, it's genuine, you know. I remember doing the Give It To Me Good video. Prior to doing it, we had, you know, we cited Give It To Me Good as our first major single, and we were going to shoot a video for it, and the record company sent us all these, what they call video treatments from all these directors, said, I have a vision. I see this. You should be flying through the clouds. You should be doing this. We're like, what? You know, it's like, that's not us. I think one thing about Trickster, we always wanted it to be what we're all about, not attempt to paint a picture of what we're not all about. We should be all about. It's what we're all about. So we said, look, we want to direct this video. We want to, what do? We ride dirt bikes. We play music. We're with the girls, play football in the park. And we have a great fun time at the diner. Let's put that in the video. And that's what we did, you know, and guess what? Number one, 8 weeks, God bless America. So, you know, I don't, you know, and we didn't put no fancy crap in there. It was just us being us. And, you know, it proved to be the right thing to do, because that's what we believe was the right thing to do. I think that's pretty much how we've handled, you know, everything through our career, what we felt was right from inside, you know, some good guidance along the way. But we certainly didn't try to be something we're not. And I think that's integral to having a great brand. You know, having a real band and reflecting what you're all about.
Yeah, and you've had, what, 4 or 5 albums?
Let's see. It started with Trickster, called Trickster, the first record, then was Here.
Right.
In 92. Then we had Undercovers, is that right? And then we took our break. We did a best of thing. Then we did Alive in Japan, then New Audio Machine, and Human Era. I think that's all of them. I think that's it.
I got part of that on Spotify, and it is. I don't think it. I think it actually doesn't have one of them on there.
Might not have covers. I don't know.
Yeah, it doesn't have covers. There's a Alive in Japan thing on there, but
bingo.
But
well, yeah, that's the way to do. Look on Spotify or Amazon. I'm sure you'll see them all. But
you know,
we've been very fortunate. We've been very, very fortunate.
What I like though is that, you know, I remember on, you know, somebody asked you, you know, are you going to put out, you know, when are you going to put out another album, you know, or are you going to put out another album, you know? And I like the answer, you know, if we get together and the time's right and, you know, we get the music together and it's a good marriage, then we'll do it. Otherwise, no. I mean,
let me tell you something. When we disbanded in 95, I didn't know that we were going to have another record. I thought maybe that was it. I really didn't know, you know. I think we all believed that one day we'd get back together and play shows. But as far as making another record, I didn't know. I didn't really anticipate it. And I remember the day Steve came to me. He's like, dude, we're going to make another record. And I was hesitant at first. I was very hesitant. You know, like we talked about earlier, so many of the bands that I listened to back in the day were coming out with new records. And I hate to say them, a lot of them sucked, you know. And the last thing I ever wanted was Trickster to put out a product that sucked. You know, something we didn't believe in, something like, oh, we, you know, I don't want to just put out a record for the sake of putting out a record, you know. But when Steve started playing the demos he had for the new thing, and PJ had contributions, Pete had contributions, you know, I started listening, like, man, we got something going here. We got to make a record, you know. But yeah, ultimately, at the end of the day, it's not about just putting out product. It's about putting out stuff that you believe in, some great stuff, you know. You got to believe it, even if everybody hates it. If you believe in it, I believe that's a core element of a step in the right direction. You know, and that's important, man. I truly believe that. So, you know, putting out a record, people think it's wonderful. To put out a crap record, that's unacceptable. So I think you really got to be cautious. You know, number one starts with the belief from your heart. You know, just like a great song, I think that, you know, the real core elements make a song. You know, it's got to start from inside, and what you feel is the right thing. You know, your morality barometer or something.
Well,
and,
damage you. It damages you.
All over the place. Mm-hmm.
You know, if you put out crap, then you may never listen to you again.
Agree. Yeah, it's a one hell of a way to kill your fan base. Absolutely.
Yeah. So, since The Grudge was kind of the death of, you know, the greatest era of music, you know, really, yeah, I'm kind of getting the feeling now that we're getting kind of a full circle on that. Now, I think a lot of the grunge, besides the ones, you know, like the, like the Alice in Chains and the Stone Temple Pilot, that sort of music is still kind of hanging there, and decent music. I like it.
Mm-hmm.
The Nirvana stuff, not so much. But the, you kind of feel like look at 2020, some of these reunions that are coming out.
Well, yeah, that tells you something, doesn't it? You know, there's still a market of people to play to in that genre that absolutely love that genre. And I think it's also funny. These people are getting older. They have their own kids, and they're bringing the kids to the show. And now one person going to the show is now two people or three people going to the show. So if anything, this genre, I believe, is growing, you know, and more people that have repeat tours that are strong inside. And come on, they're doing stadiums, for crying out loud. They're not doing clubs. They're not doing theaters. They're not even doing arenas. They're playing freaking stadiums, pal, and you're getting big money to do it. People are willing to pony up to go see a show of that magnitude, of that genre. That says something to me, you know. People say, oh, rock is dead. Oh, really? Is rock dead? Okay, because, you know, those tickets are going on sale about 200 a clip, and they're going to sell out. Okay, so, you know, you tell me what's happening, pal. You know, some people need a smack across the head just to figure it out. But, you know, it's not me doing it. You know, I wish it were. But, you know, that's a reflection of what's going on in society, at least in America today. I'm going to see how the sales go. Check out Polestar magazine. And, you know, believe me, I think there's going to be some beautiful magic happening in 2020. That's for sure.
Yeah, some of them I couldn't believe that we're getting back together. You know, of course, and then Whitesnake and Scorpions are going to tour together. That's a huge tour.
Yeah, nice package. Yeah, it's another thing, too. And sometimes maybe a band on their own can't stand, but you put a nice package together like that, you know, that's magic, you know. You got to think on that level. You really do. And make, you know, not to mention, you know, it costs more to go to a show these days. You better make it worthwhile of the ticket price. Oh, you know, yeah. I believe that, you know, and that's the smart way to approach it. And that's one thing we did. And I think why when we did our Blood, Sweat, and Beers tour back in 91, why it was so successful We did a lower ticket price, and we gave them value. There were three fantastic bands, Warrant, Firehouse, and Trickster. And let me tell you something, pal. We knocked it a heck of a lot farther than we thought we were going to do. We started the tour with several dates, and it was nice, but it grew to places like the World Amphitheater in Chicago, 30,000 people. And when we found out we sold that out, I couldn't believe it, you know? I mean, we really impressed ourselves, and then more dates got added. When the promoters saw that we were bringing crowds, you know, and selling tickets, I mean, holy cow, what do you not play show? You play more. And we were very, very fortunate in that regard. So, you know, I see that sort of thing happening now. They're realizing, you know, if we want to fill these joints, let's give them some value. Let's give the people what they deserve, you know? And they're going to make money at the merch stand. They're going to make it at concessions. They're going to make it at parking. And I hate to make it talk about money, but I hate to say it, that's a reality of what it's all about. And if you don't take that into consideration for the benefit of the fan, that's something that can't be overlooked. You cannot shortchange the people. And I think that's something Trickster has never done. You know, we will not do that. And I'd rather be on a successful tour with a multitude of bands than just play a show by ourselves. I mean, that makes it fun for everybody.
Yeah, Garth Brooks is a good example of somebody that your ticket price, if it's a nosebleed or if it's down front, it's the same price. And Kid Rock's another one that's been trying to put it into place.
Different people have different views on that sort of thing, but I'll tell you, you know, at the end of the day, people are going to respect value. And if there's no value in your package, I think that's truly going to have a detrimental effect to your future success.
Yeah, and I wrote myself off on the whole crew tour, to be honest with you. I thought they were going to just completely stick it to people. But I thought that a couple hundred bucks a person wasn't too bad of a deal if you could get a good, you know, a decent seat of where it was at. I mean, you know, four legendary bands. And we're going. I gave in and we're going, so.
There you go. God bless. Enjoy. You'll probably have a great time. And that's the thing. Man, there's no other place you can go. I remember my first concert. Oh, my God. Foreigner 4 when they came around. And when those lights go down and that whole audience erupts, gets out of their seat and jumps, starts screaming, where else are you going to go to feel something like that? That's priceless. You know, if you got a band that does, I remember going to see Van Halen. I cried when Van Halen went on stage. I freaking went nuts, you know? It was like, oh, my God, it was one of the greatest things of my life just to experience, you know? And so, you know, I couldn't wait for them to come around at any price. I didn't even have the best seats, but being a part of that energy, man, oh, my God, it was the greatest thing in the world, you know? And to go see that for a band you love, the music you love, you know? And for the most part, there's a price point, whether you're in the nosebleeds or down low. You know, right. You don't have to spend $1 million to go see a show. You can experience that from anywhere for the right price. And you know, the better the package, the more value there is to the thing. And again, I think particularly today, things are tougher. Things are more expensive. I think value is a component that sometimes gets overlooked. And I believe strongly it can never be overlooked.
Right, right. So you mentioned that you all toured with Warrant. I have to ask, because Warrant actually played in a bar in our town here in Parkersburg. I can't remember the year. Doesn't matter. It was a kick-ass concert. There was no more than maybe 300 or 400 people that could only fit in the bar. This was when they were, it was when they'd hit hard. I mean, they were still popular. What was Janie Lane like?
Janie was right off the bat, to give you an idea. When we first started touring, it was summer of 91. The package on the Blood, Sweat, and Beers tour was Warrant, Trickster, and Firehouse. Now, all three bands were in the same genre, and all three bands were really kicking some butt. Warrant was on their second record out, and they were just making that conversion from opener to headliner. And they had Cherry Pie albums going very strong. Trickster, we were riding high. We had three number one videos on MTV. We were rocking. Firehouse just came out. They had a top 40 single with Don't Treat Me Bad, and Love of a Lifetime was just about to pop. So, man, each band was rocking. Talk about value in a package. And I think we tried to keep the ticket price at $25 or less. I truly believe we could not have done better right off the bat. So meeting Janie Lane in that situation, when everybody was riding high, What a vibe. You know what I mean? All the bands, all the individuals, everybody's just so geared towards kicking ass and rocking and conquering America and conquering the world. You know, it was really something special. And one thing is sure, Janey led the party. He was the guy that, you know, who had the leg up on the front of the boat and said, that way. You know? And everybody's like, here we go. And one thing about him, he had the right attitude. It was rock and roll all day, all night, you know, and no matter what he did the night before, he was partying, having fun, kicking butt, getting drunk. The next day he would wake up and he'd be on stage on time, kicking butt, sounding fantastic, not copping out on the high notes because he had too much drink the night before. Not complaining, oh, my voice is all scratchy, I was smoking too much. He'd get on there and, like a pro, kick it in the ass every night. Oh, I swear to God, not trying to just perk up a man for the sake of perking him up. I'm telling you, that is exactly what happened. And anybody that saw the Blood and Sweat and Beers tour in 91, which was, oh, a couple million people, you ask them how he sang every night. He didn't have an off night. He kicked ass every night. And to have a pro like that, and also a pro in the party department, I mean, it was a rare combination, you know. And from a personal standpoint, he treated people with a lot of love. He was very kind to me, very generous, and a lot of fun. He just wanted to have fun and everybody have a good time. And when it came time to rock and roll, and you know, he was the first one to step on that stage and kick it in the ass. And he certainly gained respect from me. And he gained my friendship, and he taught me how to drink tequila like nobody else.
And he apparently had some demons hanging out there as well. It's just kind of...
Yeah, that's something that's come out more recently. And to be honest with you, I really can't really speak on that, because the times that we were together, we were having fun. Everything was wonderful. He was great. You know, I never really got to see him in that world. You know, I think things like that started to haunt him maybe after that time, you know, at least I and we spent a lot of time together. We would ride each other's buses. You know, we spent months together, you know, touring across America, touring around the world. And it was amazing. And it was never that sadness. I never experienced that, to be honest with you. You know, it was a very high time. So maybe I was very fortunate in that regard, but, you know, I just never really got to see that dark side. And if that is true, then you know, that makes me sad to hear it. It really does. And my heart does go out to him. You know, I know what it's like to be plagued with demons. And, you know, for someone that I know, that I believe his heart was good. I really do. I say that in all honesty. And to think that he might have been plagued with something like that, that saddens me. It truly does.
Yeah, Rob Mason does a fantastic job, you know, doing...
Love Rob. He's another fellow Arizona brother. He, you know, talk about a pro vocalist. Oh, my God. That's some... He can freaking sing like a son of a gun, you know, whether it's he works with The End Machine or with Warrant. I've seen him, you know, sing with Lynch Mob, all kinds. I mean, the man's unstoppable. He's a true pro kick-ass vocalist. And, if you know, Janey Lane had some big shoes to fill. Let me tell you. Go see Warrant today with Robert Mason. He'll kick your ass. I love him very much. I love him very much.
Yeah, we saw him in M3 this past year. Totally agree. Yeah, I mean, if you could clone a Janey, that would have been it. You know,
right.
It's just not a better fit, really.
He's a fun guy too. He's silly. He's a lot of fun. I like Rob very much.
One more question around music. Is there one song that you think of right now that's going to be able to stand the test of time with, you know, we've got all these, what's the one song you think that's out, like a newer song out right now that could possibly be the Back in Black?
God, a newer song. That's a good question, you know. And when you put me on the spot, that makes it tougher, because I probably was thinking about something this morning, but now I've totally forgot about it, and now I'm actually thinking about it. It doesn't work that way.
No, but that's all right.
If I think for a second, some newer rock that's come out, at least in the rock vein, or even any other song, I'm really trying to think. I don't know, man. I could just, you know, it's, maybe it's my drummer mentality. I was listening to something last night. a female artist named Sia, S-I-A, Sia. And she did a remake for the San Andreas movie with The Rock. And it was the Mama and Papa song about California. I can't even say what the hell it was. All the leaves are brown and the sky is gray. California Dreaming. She did a remake of that that knocked me the frick out. Now, that is a classic song right off the bat, and people do, but she did a version of that that's knocked me out. And I'm trying to think of a rock song that knocked me out like that. And, you know, when I think about it right now, a newer song today that's come out that you say may stand the test of time, that's, oh, man, I'll tell you what, I got to really think about that. I don't even know if I can answer. You know, we start talking about something else, maybe something will pop in my head, but I don't know, man. I really don't know. I got to give it some. Is there another Sister Christian out there? Is there another Back in Black, as you say? Is there another You Got Another Thing Coming? You know, is there there's some anthemic, something amazing that's going to stand that test? I don't know. I think that's something lacking in today's music overall that I think there's a hunger for it. You know, I hunger for it. You know, I want there to be. But I, right now, at least when you put me on the spot, I can't think of one.
That's why Hair Nation works so well.
Yeah, well, let me tell you, it would be a vocal like Robert Mason to be on a song like that. That's for sure. Yeah, come on. You know, I want some real virtuosity. I want to hear some talent when it comes to something like that. Robert's a fine candidate to lead the vocal charge on something like that. Absolutely, without question. You know. But, I mean, I hear some great songs from my brothers, Warrant. Guys in Firehouse, they're putting out some new music. Sounds pretty darn good, man. You know, and they think these are real players. These guys sound fantastic. You know, I'm trying to think of other artists that might fit that bill. And I just got to give it a little thought, man. I really do.
Yep. Well, that's kind of where I sit, too. I mean, I'm just kind of putting a stamp on that, I guess. It's just it's few and far between. It's not as
yeah, I think that's something we should all shoot for, you know, putting that quality back into what, you know, put some heart into what's going on. And I think that's something that'll truly stand the test of time, not overly produce something or other, but it's got to have that core element of something inside that comes out, you know, and that's super important.
So how do you feel about music and politics? I don't want to get into politics because there's too many other shows about that, but
there's, you know, I think first off, the way some of that starts, when you have a political candidate running for office, they attempt to get an artist that has a message in their song that exemplifies their campaign, that, you know, tries to broadcast their message or put the depth upon their message or broaden the demographic footprint of what their message is all about, you know, and that's, you know, I respect that, you know, but I think that's where politics music starts. To join forces, and then it's also, you know, artists that talk about political, you know, barometers within the, you know, got their fingers on the pulse of the political climate in the country, things like that. And sometimes they speak negatively about it, sometimes they'll speak positively about it. But how many songs do you hear from the Vietnam era about the war, things like that? Or, you know, even today with the political things of JFK, Martin Luther King, you know, certain political subjects that are happening in life. Heck, Trickster did one called Nobody's a Hero. You know, yeah. So I think a lot of bands, you know, reflect about politics and music. And that's a reflection of what the climate of politics is all about. You know, it's a part of the world we grow up in. And music is a reflection of what what society is really all about. I think we'll see, you know, echoes of that throughout our music, throughout our movies, throughout what is said in the news. And I think, you know, musicians are part of really broadcasting that to mass media, to bring it to the public's attention. That's something important. You know, whether you like it or not, that's subjective. And, you know, there's some things I like, some things I don't. But it's a part of reality, that's for sure. And I think it ends up being a platform of what people like to, you know, talk about in their songs.
Yeah, that makes sense. I agree with that.
You know, it's like it's something they feel passionate about, whether against something or for something. It has passion. And I think that's an element to be introduced into songs, whether you like it or not. You know, I think it sparks an idea. If someone likes Donald Trump, they'll put a big Trump shirt on there. Ah, Trump. Yeah, yeah, yeah. There's other people that are going to write something about it, about why they like something, or maybe why they don't like something, mm-hmm. You know. And I think that's really what encompasses you know, politics and music. And I think we see that in many different genres. Absolutely.
All right. So let's just switch gears here a little bit. A lot of people on here may not know that you've done a little bit of you done movie producing as well, or just mainly the scores on it and the music?
You mean as far as movies and whatnot?
Yeah, because I guess I'm switching into we talked a little bit before the broadcast about the movie that you worked on, the Monkey King.
Yes, sir. Yeah, that's the first movie project I worked on as far as introducing score, as far as putting music to motion picture. That's really something amazing. I think a lot of people don't realize the importance of putting sound to movies. You know, try watching a movie with the sound turned off, you know, and a lot of people, you'll get the idea pretty quick of really what it's all about. And the idea that it evokes an emotion in a scene. You know, you can have a nice, beautiful girl on a thing and a guy's kissing her, but if you don't have that something going on behind it, that certain music that makes the scene come alive, that makes the emotion blossom, that's really what it's all about. So, the importance of music within a movie is of vital, vital importance. And, to have the opportunity to do something like that, that was amazing for me. It really was. And if people want to hear, you can go to YouTube, punch up Mark Gus Scott, The Monkey King. And you'll see a bunch of music that I've done for the Monkey King movie and for the video games as well.
Yeah, and I encourage it. I did a little bit while I was folding some laundry there earlier. Actually, I was kind of listening to some of them, and it's quite impressive. You banging the drums behind behind a rock band. You know, a lot of times people don't see the other side of the people's talent, and it, so I was impressed with it. So
I appreciate it. Thank you. Yeah, it was a lot of fun, a lot of work. But you know what? At the end of the day, I'm very proud of the way it came out. And to see your music behind a scene in a movie, there's nothing like it. It's pretty awesome. And again, when we finally make the conversion to the to full English movie for the Monkey King and bring it out around the world, that's going to be really something amazing. I'm very anxious for that to happen. Really am.
Now, are you still part of Global Star Productions then?
I operate as an associate producer, well, one of the lower level producers, but as far as the music, it's on the upper end. A lot of music supervision. I'm the primary orchestrator as far as the video games are concerned. You know, it's kind of funny, the work I do with it is somewhat erratic. Sometimes I'm extraordinarily busy with it, and other times I got absolutely nothing to do. So, you know, it's kind of funny. And that's pretty much the way music has been for me throughout the whole career, whether it's Trickster, whether it's the movie stuff, whether I'm doing a Christmas album. The idea of working on a project, when you're actually doing it, you're a busy son of a gun. But when it's done, you got nothing else to do. It's all on, it's all in the can. So it's kind of funny in that regard. But, at the end of the day, you have product to listen to, and you can just go to YouTube and check it out. And that's very satisfying to put it on once in a while and say, man, that kicks some butt. I'm very proud.
It's relaxing. It's very relaxing.
Thank you.
You know, and from a solo project, you've put out a Christmas album,
mm-hmm.
Trumpet.
Yep, Christmas Miracle. Put it about 2 years ago, and I got to tell you, every Christmas it pops up, people seem to be running for it. So it's kind of cool. It has a narrow window as far as the time. I mean, how much Christmas music during the course of the year do you really listen to? And it's only just after Thanksgiving till the week after Christmas, and that's it. Come New Year's, it's done. You're not listening to any more Christmas music. It's over, But it's kind of fun. And I got to tell you, all these projects outside of Trickster that I've done, I only did it because I had nothing else to do. You know, it's kind of funny when guys in the band were off doing some other project or something, I was sitting around saying, well, now what the hell am I going to do? And I, some people helped me get ideas to do this, do that. It was Pete Lauren, the singer from Trickster, said, well, you should put out a trumpet record. Sounds real good. I said, well, what am I going to do? I didn't want to put together a whole bunch of songs and make a record. What am I going to, And I said, by the time I get all those songs together, put out a record, it'll be Christmas time. We looked at each other like, oh my God, what a great idea, So that's exactly how it happened, It's like Pete egging me. He's like, dude, do a record. I'm like, I don't know, you know, I was like being kind of negative about it. But once I had that focus of Christmas in mind, I was like, holy crap, that could really be cool. And yeah, it was. And, you know, you want to hear some of that stuff? I welcome people. Go to YouTube. Just punch up Marcus Scott Christmas Miracle. And you can hear some stuff on there. You can get an idea what it sounds like. But don't get the wrong idea. This is not a heavy metal Christmas record. It's right. a real deal white bread Christmas record. You know what right. I mean? So, and I love it. You know, I started playing trumpet before I played drums. So, you know, it's an amazing thing. I think it's awesome. And yeah, I'd love people to hear it. It's really cool.
And you and PJ both now have done solo projects, right?
Yeah, PJ did Boutique Sound Frames album. It sounds freaking great. And, you know, when you do things outside the band, everybody should do something. Sure,
yes, God. Absolutely.
You know? Pete Lauren did a solo album as well, you know. Steve's involved with 100 different projects he's put out records for, you know. And, dude, that's wonderful. And let me tell you, it's good to take a break from the band. When you come back with the band, hello, it gives you a new freshness, something new, and you want to do it all together. But yeah, everybody should be off doing something. That's great. It's fine, you know. But we'll see what the future might bring. We'll see.
Yep. Well, I enjoyed PJ's too, so I don't know if you pass it on to him or not, but maybe I'll have him on the show one of these days. I don't know.
Bingo. There you go. Will do.
And then, so this last thing here, kind of with you, the single. That come from an experience?
Yes, it did, actually. You know, it's funny talking about it, you know, after so much time. But yeah, to be honest with you, I didn't really even plan for it to be like this solo single thing. It was the first time I think I successfully put together a song that was from my heart. And I tried songwriting in the past and probably not so successful at it. And more recently, I don't know, this there was something that was really inside of me. And when it came to, you know, telling someone that you love them and you felt that strongly about it, you would do anything to try to convey that message. So With You started as just me writing down words on paper and, you know, trying to make a song out of the way I felt, you know. And sometimes I get a little wordy, you know, trying to convey what's in your heart and make it sound rhythmically nicer. Phonetically nice and make it, you know, sound good, you know, in the rhyming sense, you know, that's a challenge. At least it was for me. So trying to make what you felt and keep it true to what you feel inside and make it sound good at the same time. That was my real challenge. So it took me a while to make that happen and then place the music with it as well. Melody lines along with the lyrics and with the music behind it. And I got to tell you, I'm so proud with the way it came out. You know, it was amazing to see the reception it's gotten. I certainly didn't expect. I you know, I just wanted to make this song to tell this one woman how I felt about her, and it's turned into this thing. And I think that's awesome. I'm blown away. I really am, and I'm very proud of the song. I'm glad people like it, and I'm anxious for more to come.
Yeah, this just a single? Does that mean there is more? You get more written that you're going.
Single, and then we did a dance mix as well, the extended dance mix. That's right. Pretty cool. I've got a special in February. We're going to do a big Valentine's Day promotion because it's about love. For the month of February, you will be able to download my song With You for free at my website. So come February 1st, just go to marcusscott.com. You can download it for free. The reason why is I want people to share this with the people they love. I think when you feel that strongly about somebody, you know, sometimes people have a hard way of communicating it, you know, but you should never not say anything. So if my song can help with that at all, you know, I'd be honored for that to happen. So month of February, marcusscott.com, download With You for free and share it with the one you love. That's really what Valentine's is all about.
The piano in that is amazing too. I
appreciate that. Thank you very much. Yeah. I mean, and I guess because I've been playing piano since I was like 8 years old, I never really thought twice about it, you know. I just did it, and I've been getting a lot of feedback that's positive, and I'm honored. I really am, and it's one of those things I really didn't think about, you know, and it's just sort of happened that I'm very, very happy, and I love the way the piano sounds, you know, my playing. I love the way I played on it. I knocked out the whole thing in two takes. The first take took you to the break at the end, and I stopped playing. I took a break. So I listened back, and then I picked it up from the end on out. So basically, it was one take with a break in the middle, you know. And I'm just so happy with the way I play, you know. I'm playing. I was just trying to get emotion out, you know, and particularly in the dance mix, trying to get it sounding fun in the rock section, the section where the drums start up. I just wanted it to be flowing. I wanted that energy to feel great, you know. I wanted it to be something special. I really tried to capture that, and I think I just I just really nailed it. And Pete Lorne helped me with that. He engineered it, and I can't tell you how happy I am with the way it came out. And, you know, doing with Pete also, what a great time we had. It was something special. You know, I might have drove him a little crazy at times, because there's like 80 tracks on that damn song. He had to mix it. So I know he gets 50. I say, dude, I want to do a song. He looks at me and goes, oh, boy. So, you know, he says it like half joking. I mean, half, he's serious, because it is a complete pain in the ass. I feel bad for him. But the other half is like, you know, we put out some cool stuff together. And at the end of the day, we put it on. We look at it, it's like, that sounds pretty good. You know, we're, you know, so, and same thing with the movie stuff. Pete helped engineer all the, well, not all, you know, a lot of the Monkey stuff, Monkey King stuff for the video game. You know, Pete was involved with that. Special effects sounds, background music, making loops, stuff like that. He helped with a lot of it. So, you know, I really enjoy working with Pete. He's a very competent engineer, competent in production. And honestly, I'm not. So he certainly helps me a lot. He really does.
Now, did any of the guys in the band graduate from college with certain degrees or anything? That
I went to the University of Hartford, Hart School of Music. But okay. I went there when I was like a sophomore in high school. Okay. I went to the got in on scholarship for early acceptance in music program. It was pretty cool. I guess for people that played well, they wanted them to go to this program. So it was me and a bunch of kids from around the country in Canada that were brought into the University of Hartford, and we got to learn under their faculty, under their staff, and special guest conductors that came in, and we would make a whole double album of classical music every summer. So I went 3 summers and made 3 double albums of classical music. It was amazing, you know, and just playing with people of that caliber that could play that well, you know, put them all in a room together and give them some instruction and direction. Holy crap. I mean, you got to hear this stuff. It was next level. And I was like in the middle as far as how well I played. There were guys better than me. There were people not quite as good. But just being right in that spot, it was pretty cool to see just how good people, you know. I mean, there are people that play the horn like, oh, my God, I'll never be that good. You know, now, like, you know, my age, I'm like, Jesus, what the hell are you doing? You know, it's really amazing to see. It's inspiring, too. But when everybody gets together with the right attitude and that kind of talent, it's amazing what comes out. It's really something beautiful.
Well, it sounds like you got your head on straight. You know,
Well, I don't know about that, but.
Well, I mean, it does take a certain amount of discipline to do what all of you have done, you know, to manage to keep the marriage together, so to speak.
Well, we've been very fortunate. We really have. It's been a nice long run. We'll see what the future may bring. I don't know. Yeah. But right now, everybody's off doing their own thing. And I really don't know where it's going to go from here. You know, I'm hopeful to play more with everybody. But they got to want to do it. They got to want to do it for the right reasons. They got to have it in their heart. And if it ain't there, then, you know, I don't know. But one thing's sure, I'll keep doing something. And right now, my song with you is something very special to me. And the reaction has been extraordinary. I've been very, very fortunate. And I truly believe, at least the formula that's worked for me over time, if it comes from the heart, you're doing something right, you know?
Right.
And I'm not trying to be something that I'm not trying to take credit for something that I haven't done. And I think that's something very, very important to me. And come 2020, we're here. There's more to be done, and I'm anxious to show more to the world.
And it's not going to happen unless you try. So that's something that that's one thing that another thing people should admire you for, doing things like that. So,
yes, sir. Greg, I can't tell you how much I appreciate everything, sir. Thank you very much for having me.
Yeah, my pleasure, man. I'm actually. I think we're kind of toward the end here. I really do appreciate you taking your time and especially your patience through my gremlins here in the studio. I've gotten to got
well,
more.
Craig, when you go up to Vegas, you better tell me when it's going to be, because we're going to party, my friend. I'm just a short drive away.
Yes, I will absolutely. I'll let you know how soon you need to know. A couple weeks ahead of time or so?
Well, if you're going to be there tomorrow, you better let me know in the next 10 minutes.
It's not going to be. I wish. I wish we were going to be out there for that McGregor fight, but no.
That would be something, right? That would be a hell of a night.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Those nights are awesome.
Well, be sure to keep in touch with me, my friend. Please do.
Yep, sure will. Thanks, Mark. I appreciate your time, and, you know, I look forward to more of what you do. And, of course, more of Trickster, of course. So, but you as well. So,
Craig, thanks so much for everything. Robert's Report, keep kicking butt, my friend.
Thank you.
An honor.
Have a great evening. All right, everybody. So there you have it, Mark, Gus, Scott from Trickster. I appreciate all of the new listeners on here today. I hope that you go over to the Roberts Report page and like it. We're going to have more. Actually, I got somebody else. Nope. I think Mark may have butt-dialed me there or something. But anyway, guys, I really appreciate everybody, all the new people that come on and listen. We will be having more of the new. We'll have my next interview is going to be with Hugo of Tantric here in a couple weeks, and then we're also going to have I don't know if you're familiar with Bill Chavis. He's management and got a couple bands out there right now, Air Mother's Nightmare and Asphalt Valentine, that are doing really well. And we're going to have him on here to kind of talk about the music business as well. But I do appreciate everybody tuning in. And, of course, like I mentioned to Mark there, of being patient through all of the gremlins here in the studio. Go like the page. Go see Mark's page and make sure you go check out his YouTube channel. You will not be disappointed in anything that he has put out. It's quite amazing. So, everybody, you have a fantastic evening, and peace out. Oh, yeah. Code Red Riot, Shell Aside. Two bands provide our music for the podcast. Make sure you go out and check them out. New music in 2020 for them. Peace out, everybody. Have a great Sunday evening.